Hallo? Today we will start an interesting topic, approximation algorithms, which are often used to solve very difficult problems. Approximation algorithms are actually applicable only to optimization problems. So, of course, we have so far talked about decision problems to be in NP, class NP and all that stuff. I will start with a revision of this notion of NP for optimization problems. And then we will see how approximation algorithms can solve several interesting difficult problems in polynomial time. Okay. To start with, let me add some formal treatment of optimization problems. Okay. So let P be an optimization problem. So by optimization, we mean either a minimization problem or a maximization problem. It may be any one of this. Okay. Now let us say I is an input instance for P and the set of all possible output instances corresponding to I be the set OI. Okay. In fact, we will assume that this set is finite, and for a reason that will be clear soon, the size of this set may be at most exponential in the size of the input I. It cannot be bigger. Now, for each possible output, I can associate a real value. So there is a function f from its feasible output to set of real numbers. May be positive, may restrict to positive things, but it's not necessary. And this is called the objective function. Okay. And now the goal of this optimization problem P is to find one O star in this. Okay. A feasible output O star such that the following thing happens. If it is a minimization problem, then the objective value achieved by O star is less than equal to the objective value achieved by O for any other O in this. And if it is a maximization problem, the objective achieved by O star is greater than equal to the objective achieved by any other feasible solution. So this thing holds for all O in this set of feasible outputs. Okay. So, okay. Now here is a small thing. If several O star achieve the same maximum or minimum objective value, we can output any one of them arbitrarily. Okay. So that's not a big issue. Now, instead of writing this f of O star, we often denote this optimal output, and O star is the optimal feasible output, but its objective value is often denoted by OPT underscore I subscript I, or I simply write OPT when I is implicit from the context. Now, given this formal definition of optimization problems, I introduce a concept of non-deterministic polynomial time algorithms for optimization problems like this. So we say that this P is an optimization problem in NP if the following two conditions hold. First, it is easy to test the membership of some feasible output or some sum output in this, okay, that is whether some output is feasible or not, it's easy to test that thing. And second, given a feasible output, it is easy to compute the objective function f of O, objective value of that thing, okay, for every O in there. Let us see, why do I call it non-deterministic polynomial time? You may think of a non-deterministic algorithm like this. So maybe I'll just scribble something here. So something like this, generate all E, all O by making a sequence of guesses. Okay. Check if O is in this set Y, compute f of O. Of course, if yes, if the check succeeds, and then return f of O. Okay. So now, when we talked about non-deterministic algorithms for decision problems, there was a mechanism that collects the return values 0 or 1 from all non-deterministic guesses and somehow makes a logical OR of this return values. If anyone is 1, then the answer is 1. Now, similarly, we can think about a mysterious mechanism that can take the minimum of this return values. Okay. So instead of ordering, now I am doing the minimum calculation of all these return values. So what is that mysterious mechanism? So you can think about a parallel computer. So technically, what is called a common concurrent read, concurrent write, parallel random access machine. If the size of this is P, then you actually require P square processors. Okay. But then the minimum for a minimization problem or maximum for a maximum maximization problem can be computed in just O one time. This can be done. So it makes sense to talk about this as a non-deterministic algorithm. Anyway, so that is anyway fine, but so we can formally port our definition of non-deterministic polynomial time to optimization problems also. Anyway, this is not a very important issue in this context. Okay, now they are also in a formal sense related to the decision problems. Okay, so let's say you take an input I for the problem P and you choose a bound B and consider this decision problem. Decide whether there exists a feasible output O such that the objective achieved by O is less than or equal to B for a minimization problem or greater than or equal to B for a maximization problem. Now, how this is related to the original problem, that is, this is something like this. If you can choose this bound B appropriately, then the decision problem is solvable in polynomial time if and only if the optimization problem can be solved in polynomial time. I will give you an example what I mean by this. And this essentially establishes the fact that the decision problem is in NP in the earlier sense, if and only if the optimization problem is in NP in the newly defined sense of NP. So let us see an example. Let Z be an undirected graph. So you know undirected graphs have vertex covers. So consider this minimum vertex cover problem. So find the smallest vertex cover of Z. Whereas we have already looked at a decision version of this. Given this graph G and some positive integer K, decide whether G has a vertex cover of size equal to K or less than equal to K. Whatever. Now, k can take values like 1, 2, 3, up to n minus 1, okay, or n maybe, 0 to n, okay. So, if you have an efficient algorithm for this decision problem, then you just run that decision problem for k equal to n, n minus 1, n minus 2, and eventually you can solve this minimum vertex cover problem. On the other hand, if you have an efficient algorithm for the minimum vertex cover problem, just run it and find out the size of the minimum vertex cover. If that is less than or equal to k, say yes. If not, say no. Okay. Therefore, this appropriate choices of B in this case can be made. Anyway, now, having seen this formal introduction to optimization problems and classifying them as optimization problems in NP, let us now start our study of approximation algorithms. As the name suggests, approximation algorithms do not solve a problem, an optimization problem to be more precise, exactly, but it solves the problem approximately. That is, instead of giving optimal solutions, it furnishes something called suboptimal solutions, which may be poorer than optimal solutions. So that is the basic idea. If finding the optimal solution is very, very difficult, I may have to keep myself happy with only suboptimal or approximate solutions. Provided that I can compute those suboptimal solutions in polynomial time. Okay. So, at least I have some solution, not the best solution, but something possibly close to the best. Okay, so formally, let P be an optimization problem in NP, and let A be an algorithm that addresses or tends to solve P. We call A row approximation algorithm for some positive integer, for positive real number rho, for p, for all inputs I, A produces some output O, which did not be optimal, but for a minimization problem, the objective achieved is more than rho times the optimum value, provided we are talking about minimization problems. Or if you are talking about maximization problems, the objective achieved by O is smaller than rho times the optimal value. Okay, so this rho is some kind of guarantee how bad the approximate solution is in relation to the optimal solution. This is called the approximation ratio or the approximation factor. So, by definition, you can see that for a minimization problem, okay, fine. So, if there are instances for which this equality is achieved, we call this row, this approximation ratio, tight. Okay. Anyway, this is a definition. We will see several examples of tight approximation ratios. And you can see that for minimization problems, rho is greater than 1 because this objective cannot be better than OPT. And for maximization problems, it's a value between 0 and 1. And as you clearly see that if we can design algorithms, approximation algorithms, for instance, this approximation guarantee is very close to 1, this is good. Okay. That is a natural demand. And second natural demand is this algorithm should be useful. So that means we require A to run in time polynomial in the size n of this input I. Okay. So this is first and basic demand. A should be efficient. And now there is another thing. This approximation ratio rho is in the sim, and therefore the running time may also depend on rho. For example, let us talk about minimization problems. The closer rho gets to 1, your approximation algorithm may actually take a longer time. Okay, so this is our formal definition of an approximation algorithm. We will see a couple of examples of approximation algorithms in today's lecture, in this lecture. But there is one caution I would like to mention here. We have defined rho this way, but in many other textbooks, you can see, so for us, rho is always f of O by OPT, irrespective of whether it is a minimization problem or a maximization problem. But for some authors, they take this definition, but for maximization problems, they take rho equal to just the opposite. For us, this is f of O by OPT. For them, it is OPT by f of O. So that these authors enjoy something for all optimization problems, irrespective of whether it is a minimization problem or a maximization problem, rho is always greater than 1. So this is a uniformity D-axis. But we will stick to this convention. For example, we will talk about it. Two approximation algorithm for a minimization problem or a half approximation algorithm for a maximization problem. But for these authors, both are two approximation algorithms. Anyway, you will find this definition in many books, but I want to mention that we will keep on following this convention. Fine. So now let us look at the minimum vertex cover problem. So, G equal to VE is an undirected graph. A vertex cover which we have already defined earlier. Let me just recall this definition. And suppose that there are n vertices and m edges. So, a subset U of V is called a vertex cover of G if every edge in this set E has at least one endpoint in U. Okay. So, this definition we have already seen, so I just quickly recapitulate it for the sake of completeness. And the minimum vertex cover problem deals with finding a vertex cover of G such that it contains as few vertices as possible. So, this is the size of U in the number of vertices. Okay, so why is this problem in NP? First of all, what was the definition? So, given a candidate, it is easy to check whether it is a feasible solution. So, if you are now given a set of a set U of vertices and a subset U of V, it is easy to check whether it is a vertex cover. Okay, and second, what is the objective achieved by U? That is counting how many vertices are there in U. That is also an easy task. Okay. So, it is easy to count the size of any vertex cover. Or for that matter, any subset U of V. Okay. So, I will now mention a couple of algorithms, approximation algorithms, for solving this minimum vertex cover problem. The first one is not so good. It is called a logarithmic approximation algorithm. Logarithmic means the row, the approximation ratio for this algorithm can be as bad as log of n. Okay. So let us look at this natural algorithm. Okay. So is u is something which you want to return as a vertex color. So you start with the original graph and find a vertex u of largest remaining degree. Okay. So this is actually a greedy step. If a vertex covers many, many edges, we pick it. And then we add u to this vertex cover, capital U. Okay. And then since u has already been taken in U, I can delete from E all the edges when U is one endpoint. Okay. These edges are already all covered by this U. Okay. So I delete from E all the remaining edges incident upon U. And once again I go. And if this U becomes empty, definitely U is already a vertex cover. Otherwise, pick another vertex of the largest remaining degree, add U to U, and again delete from U all the remaining edges with U as one endpoint. So this is definitely a greedy strategy, and you convince yourself that this is a polynomial time algorithm. Okay. It is a polynomial in the size of the graph, that is n plus n. Now, this much is fine. This is a natural greedy strategy. And now I have to establish that its approximation guarantee is by the factor of log n. This proof is somewhat involved. So, derivation of the approximation ratio. So, assume that the cover returned by this algorithm is of size k. And let us say these vertices added in the order u1. First u1 is chosen in that loop, then u2 is chosen in that loop, and so on. And finally uk is chosen, and then e becomes empty, so u is a vertex cover. Okay, so we will use this notation. So this page of slides is meant to set up the notations. Okay. So vertices added to u are this in this order. On the other hand, let's say u star is an optimal, that is minimum or minimal vertex cover, and let's say its size is t. Then my approximation ratio will be k over t. So, I have to somehow relate k and t, although t cannot be computed by some arguments, I have to establish some bound on k over t. Okay. To that effect, I think of a sequence of graphs. So, to start with, we have the full graph g, and I call it g0. Then you remove you pick u1 and remove all the edges incident upon u1. So the edge set reduces. Then what graph remains, let us call it g1. Then you remove all edges incident upon u2, and then you get a graph which I call g2. So g0, g1, g2, gk. So in general, gi is the graph after the edges incident upon u1, u2 up to ui are all removed. So, it's on the same vertex set B, only the edge set is keeping on decreasing in size monotonically. Okay. Strictly monotonically. Okay. So, let us say mi is the size of this edge set, the remaining edges. Okay. So initially, the total number of edges is n, so n0 is m, and you have this, and clearly this is a monotonic decreasing sequence, that is M0 greater than M1 greater than M2 and so on up to MK. But after this UK, you have already found a vertex cover, so this is equal to 0. Fine. So just remember this notations. Okay, so now let us see what happens when I pick a vertex UI plus 1 from GI in order to convert it to GI plus 1. So, now consider this, I have already chosen U1, U2 up to UI. Okay, so some of these vertices may be a part of U star, the optimum vertex cover, okay, the minimum vertex cover. Okay. And let us say this number is TI. TI may even be 0. This minimum possible value of TI is 0, because whatever we have chosen may have nothing in common with U star, with the vertices of U star, or it may be as big as I itself. Okay. Whatever it is, the important thing is that there are T minus TI vertices remaining in U star. Okay. Now, this is a positive quantity, because if you have chosen all the vertices of U star, then we have already found a vertex cover, and the loop has already terminated. So there is no question of going from GI to GI plus 1. So this is a positive quantity. Okay. Now you convince yourself that, okay, so obviously one thing is here, there are TI vertices in U star, and if I consider the remaining TI or T minus TI vertices, then this TI and this T minus TI, that is the total of U star, covers the entire G, and in particular it also covers GI. Okay. Now GI has MI edges left. Okay. So by the pigeonhole principle, there must be at least one vertex among these whose such that the number of edges incident upon that vertex is at least MI over T minus TI. It has to. Okay. Otherwise, the total number of vertices that can be covered by these remaining vertices will be less than MI. That's impossible. Okay. So, let us call this vertex VI plus 1. Okay. So, there exists some VI plus 1 in U1's U star minus, okay, so these are precisely the remaining T minus TI vertices of U star. TI are common, I have just taken out this from U star. So there must be a vertex by the pigeonhole principle whose degree GI is greater than or equal to MI, the number of edges remaining, over T minus TI. Now, I have to somehow relate UI plus 1 and VI plus 1. The algorithm is not bound to choose this VI plus 1. Okay. Instead, it chooses a vertex UI plus 1 that has the maximum remaining degree. So, VI plus 1 is neither in U star nor in U1, U2, UI. Okay. And its degree is already greater than or equal to this. And by the greedy choice, the degree of UI plus 1 cannot be smaller than this. Okay. So, by the greedy choice, the degree of UI plus 1 in GI must be greater than or equal to degree of VI plus 1 in GI, and which in turn is greater than or equal to this quantity. So, at least these many edges are removed from the graph GI to get GI plus 1. So, what is the number of edges left? That will be MI plus 1. and that will be less than equal to mi minus this quantity. Okay. So mi plus 1 must be less than equal to mi 1 over 1 minus this quantity. And if I want to make this formula independent of ti, I use the relation that ti can be greater than or equal to 0. So this is less than or equal to mi 1 minus 1 over t. And if I keep on applying this inequality since the beginning, I can conclude that mi is less than or equal to m0 times 1 minus 1 over t whole power I. And m0 is nothing but the original number of edges in the input graph G. Now what I do, I put a value I equal to t log m. Okay. If I put I equal to t log m, then I see that mi in that iteration less than equal to m 1 minus 1 over t log m. So if I consider only this quantity 1 minus 1 over t whole power t, we know that this is less than e to the power minus 1. Okay. So it is just 1 minus 1 over t whole power t. This is less than e power minus 1. And if this is raised to log of m, I will get 1 over m. So this m and 1 over m cancel. This is 1. This says after these many iterations, the number of edges left is less than 1. That is, this has to be 0. So this analysis implies that the number of iterations in the greedy algorithm cannot be bigger than t log m. That is, k is less than or equal to t log m. That is, the approximation ratio, which is k by t, must be less than or equal to log of m. And since n is the number of edges, its maximum possible value is n choose 2 for an undirected graph. If I take log m, so this is also big theta of log m, big O of log m, okay, or big theta of log m. This is just as the maximum possible value. So, this is how I can derive the approximation ratio even when we are unable to determine the exact value of t. This guarantee we can just, by a constructive proof, deduce. Okay. Now, of course, this is a less than equal to sign. So, in reality, is rho much smaller than this? In other words, is rho something like a constant approximation algorithm that is also big O of log n. Okay. This is where this concept of tightness of rho comes into picture. Now I will give you an example where I will show that rho can be also greater than or equal to big theta of log. Therefore, it shows that there exist instances where rho actually achieves this theta log n value. This construction is not really an easy one. Okay. I slowly explain this. This tightness of rho. We construct a bipartite graph. The top part, let us call it T. And the bottom part, let us call it B. We will have connections here, 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 here. So this is one part, this is the other part. Okay. And we say that this will be characterized by a parameter T. So that implies it's an infinite family of examples that proves tightness of rho. It can be anything. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, any positive integer. The size of t, this contains exactly t vertices. This is a bipartite graph. The size of t is t. And this b is broken down into several parts. b2, b3, b4, up to bt. bi, the ith part, contains t over I. Okay, bi contains t over I. T over I need not be an integer, so I take the floor of that quantity. This contains t over I vertices. Therefore, the total number of vertices in B is the number of vertices in B2 plus the number of vertices in B3 plus the number of vertices in B4 and so on. So, this is equal to this. Okay. This runs from 2 to t, not from 1 to t. Okay. So, another important thing is that the degree of each vertex in bi will be I. Okay. Each vertex in bi is connected to I vertices in t. So, and how many vertices are there? T by I times I. So, that means the maximum possible value of this times I is t. So, we can impose the additional restriction that no two vertices of bi share a common neighbor in t. So, vertices bi have mutually disjoint neighbor sets in t. And this is guaranteed because t by I, the floor of that, times I is at most t. And t contains t vertices. Now, let us see that this construction gives us a vertex cover for which the value of rho is big theta of log n. Okay. In order to see why this construction works, I work with a specific example. So, we are working with a specific example where t is 6. So, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. B2 will contain 6 by 2, that is 3 vertices. B3 will contain 6 by 3, that is 2 vertices. B4 will contain 6 by 4, that is just 1.5. If I take floor, this is 1, 6 by 5, 1.2, floor 1, 6 by 6 is 1. Okay. This has each vertex has degree 2, yes, and they will never share a common neighbor in 2, 2, 2, 3. 3 neighbors, 3 neighbors disjoint. B4 is only one vertex, any 4. You can choose any 4 of this. 6 vertices, 5 neighbors, any 5 neighbors you can choose, and this will have 6 neighbors, so you have to choose all the things. Okay. Now let us see what happens. Consider each vertex in this part T. They may be connected to a vertex in B2, a vertex in B3, a vertex in B4, a vertex in B5, and a vertex in B6. So, the degree of a vertex here can be at most t minus 1 because I am starting from 2, 2 to t. Whereas, if I look at this vertex, it will be connected to all of the t vertices of t. So, this is the vertex of largest degree in this current graph. Okay. So, the greedy algorithm will choose this vertex in the first step. Because this is the unit vertex of degree t. All other vertices are of degree at most t minus 1. So, the greedy algorithm chooses this in the first step. But then you look at this, the vertex, every vertex of this has a degree, has its degree reduced by 1. So, this is now t minus 2 at most. This is just 2, 3, but here 4, 4, 4, 4. But here I have a vertex that has degree 5. So, once again, this B5 is the unit vertex in this graph whose degree is the largest. This, they are just one less degree. So, the greedy algorithm choose B5. Okay. Now, again, you see the next choice is B4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 3, 3, 2, 2, 2, and here the maximum degree is 2, 3, just one less than degree of B4. So the greedy algorithm will choose B4. Good. Again, you say the greedy algorithm will choose either this or this. Maximum degree here is 2, now here it is 3. Okay. So let's say the greedy algorithm chooses the right vertex, then the left vertex. And now each one of these has degree 2, each one has degree 1. So one by one, these 3 vertices will be selected by the greedy algorithm. This, this, this. Okay. So now E has become empty. Therefore, we have constructed the vertex cover which consists of the entire bottom part. And that is the greedy algorithm's output. Okay. Now, let us do a little bit of calculation. What is the size of B? Okay. It is something like this, T over I. So, it is approximately T over I. So, it is approximately this quantity. So, if I take T out, it is close to the Tth harmonic number. Okay. So, the size of B is roughly T log T. And here I have the exact calculations. B is less than or equal to this, and that is ht minus 1. And then you know this inequality. For every n, hn less than log n plus 1, less than log of n plus 1. Okay. So it's actually b theta of log n. Anyway, so on the other hand, so here I have used this ht minus 1 less than, sorry, forward n log n. Okay. So I have used this log n minus, this n minus 1 is log n. So ht minus 1 is less than or equal to t log. On the other hand, this is greater than or equal to t minus I1, my minus 1 by I. And then you do this calculations, you will see. Size of B is greater than or equal to T minus 1 log T plus 1 minus 2. So it is bounded from above by T log T, also from below T log T, something close to that. So the size of B is, that is the output produced by the greedy algorithm, is big theta of T log T. Now think of a situation where this is a bipartite graph. So, the top part is also a vertex cover, okay. T is also a vertex cover. And what is the size of T? That is nothing but just T, okay. And the optimal vertex cover U star may include some vertices from T, some vertices from B. So, anyway, the size of U star must be less than or equal to the size of the top part, which is also a cover, vertex cover. And this you can see from this 1 over theta log T U. So what is U star over U then? This is, or I would say U over U star is theta log T. And that is the approximation relation. Okay. So U over U star is theta log T. What is the number of vertices in the graph? That is size of B plus size of T. But this is T. This is T log T. So if I add them up, this is not T log T, theta of T log T. And then if I add T, you will also get theta T log T. Okay. So if I take log N, this will be theta of log T. Okay. Theta of log T plus log T, but I can forget that log T. So it is log N and log T. Are basically bounded by theta. Okay, so this implies log of T is theta of log of N. Therefore, the approximation ratio U over U star is greater than or equal to theta log N. Okay, so this approximation ratio rho is tight. Okay, so this is not a good thing. Log n is a little bit too much as an approximation ratio. So I will look at, for the rest of this lecture, a better approximation algorithm for this which guarantees the approximation ratio of 2, a constant. Okay. So this algorithm is based upon the concept of matching. You know what matching is, so this is not a greedy algorithm, but it produces a matching alongside a vertex power. Okay, so this is based on matching. So, okay, once again, this is the recalling of the definition. The subset D in the edge set E is called a matching of the graph if these edges of D are independent. In other words, no two edges of D share an endpoint. Okay. Now, how D and vertex covers are related is this relation. Let D be any matching in G and any vertex cover. Then you see that if you consider the edges in D here, okay, they do not share a common endpoint. Means that you have to take in U at least one of the endpoints of the edges in this D. Okay. Therefore, so you must contain one endpoint of each edge in D. Okay. Otherwise, you cannot cover this match. Okay. This implies that the size of D must be less than equal to the size of U. So you may contain other vertices to cover other edges. So the size of D must be less than equal to size of U. This is a critical observation. We will use this later. Okay. So this is how matching helps us improving the approximation factor. Okay. So this algorithm is again pretty straightforward. Start with the empty vertex cover. We will not explicitly create the matching. Okay. I will tell what these matchings are. While E is not empty, okay, it's the same thing. Pick any edge. But now this is not a greedy choice. It is an arbitrary choice. You can choose any edge U, B from E. Okay. In fact, we will see that these edges will form a matching. Okay. And add both the endpoints U and V to this U. And remove U and V from V. Moreover, remove from E all the edges incident on U or V. Okay. So you have chosen both U and V to be in your vertex cover, and therefore all edges incident on U or V are already covered, therefore you can remove all these things. Also, you are removing U and V, so in a later iteration, whatever edge you pick cannot have U or V as one of their endpoints. So, the edges chosen in this step must construct a matching in the graph. Okay. So this algorithm works. Now I have to compute the approximation ratio. Okay. So this implies all the edges incident on U and V are already covered. So I can remove all these edges with impunity. They are all covered. Moreover, since U and V are removed from the graph, in a future iteration, I will not choose an edge with U or V as one of its endpoint. So the edges chosen here will form a matching in the original graph. Okay. And another important thing is that for each edge in the matching, you are adding two vertices to U. So the size of this matching the size of this vertex cover is twice the size of this matching. Okay. Anyway, so this will be needed later. Okay. Let us see Let me demonstrate this by an example. Okay, let us consider this graph. And this is not a greedy algorithm. You can choose any vertex, any edge like this, which is in E. It's two endpoints at A and B. So you just add A and B in the vertex cover and delete this, 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 and this edge. All of this incident upon A or B. So now the graph looks like this. Now you may pick any arbitrary edge that remains in this graph. So in this example, I have chosen CD. And I add both C and D to my vertex cover and delete all the edges incident upon C or D. So this is this, 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 and this. So now the graph becomes something like this. Then what I do, I once again I may choose EG or FG. In this example, I have chosen FG and I am adding both F and G to this vertex cover and deleting all the edges, this and this. So now E becomes empty. Okay. And the graph contains only the vertex E. E becomes empty. So the vertex cover that I have constructed is A, B, C, D, F, G. Okay. And also you see that the matching that I have implicitly computed is A, B, C, D, F, G. This is of size 3, whereas the vertex cover is of size 6. Okay. So now I just put together all these observations to derive the approximation ratio for this algorithm. Okay. So let D be the edges or the set of edges chosen in the loop. Okay. So it should better be called the set of edges chosen in the loop. And D is a matching. Okay. And the size of D and the size of U are related by this relation. For each edge in the matching, I have included two vertices, so U is 2D. And then I bring U star in picture, which is the optimal vertex cover. And because the size of every matching must be less than or equal to the size of every vertex cover, I in particular will have size of D, this matching, less than or equal to size of optimal vertex cover. Now I can simply put together all these inequalities and equalities. So what is D? Or sorry, what is U? U is 2 times D, and 2 times D is less than or equal to 2 times U star. Okay. So U is less than or equal to 2 times U star. Then what does it imply? The approximation ratio rho is U over U star, which is less than or equal to 2. So this is a 2 approximation algorithm. Is it now definitely we raise the question whether this approximation factor is tight or not? Now it is, I am not going to the details, but this is now very easy to check. If I look at this example, the tightness, consider the complete bipartite graph. Two parts contain n vertices each, and there is an edge from each vertices of each part to all vertices of the other part. So this is called the complete bipartite graph written as K and N. Oh, what does it mean? Take rho equal to K and N. Okay, so this is a typo. Sorry, this makes no sense. Let's take rho. Yeah. This makes little sense. And let D be the set of edges. Okay, these are two typos in this page. Anyway, so take K and N. And you can simply check that any one of these parts, top part or the bottom part, can be a vertex cover. You can actually also choose vertices in a mixed way. from this part and this part, whatever it is, the size of this will be n. But if you run this two approximation algorithm, you will see that you will eventually choose all the vertices of this graph. Okay. And you use 2n, therefore rho is this by this, which is 2. So in this example, we achieve an approximation ratio of 2. Although the guarantee is less than equal to 2, this is achieved here, and therefore this is a 2 approximation algorithm with rho being able to equal to 2 tight approximation ratio. Okay, so I think we have seen a good couple of examples of approximation algorithm. So let me stop at this point. I will continue this study of approximation algorithms in the next 2 lectures. For the moment, bye.